Hello, welcome back to GCP Security Best Practices, Q&A Part 8. Let's have a look through these new questions, set of questions and scenarios, and what we think is the right answer, which will help you in your, you know, implementation and best practices based on Google input. An org recently began using App Engine to build and host its own new web application for the customers. The org want to use an existing IAM, Identity and Access Management, set up to allow its developer employee to have alleviated access to the application remotely. This would allow them to push, update, and fix to application using HTTPS connection. Non-developer employee should only get access to the production version without permission. Which solution of GCP will meet this requirement? A sync on the org ID using cloud identity employee via VPN? No. Disable access for non-developer employee by removing their Google Cloud app access control? No. And set up cloud identity proxy, manage authentication for different authorization level? Yes. And the answer is C. Let's have a look. Yeah, the answer is C. And these are the reference for you. Next, you are part of security team investigating a compromised service account. You need to audit which new resources were created by this service account. What should you do? Query data access logs, query admin activity, access transparency, stack drive monitoring workspace. So in this scenario, because you need to query the admin, which service account, that service account, assuming it's an admin, then hence it transfers. Check the activity log because only admin can create the application, okay? Next, a business unit at a multinational corporation signs up for GCP, moving workload to GCP. The business unit create cloud identity domain with an org resource that has hundreds of projects. Your team becomes aware of this and wants to take over managing permission and the auditing side of it. What type of access should you, your team grant to meet this requirement? Org admin, security reviewer, org role administrator, or policy admin? The answer is C. You need to assign a role admin to it. Yeah. Next, an application often requires access to a secret, small piece of information, the admin managing these secrets and keep track of who, when, and how. By whom, which two log streams would you utilize to provide some information about, you know, who is accessing what? Admin activity log, system event, data access log, VPC flow, and agent log. So the answer is A and C. Okay, A and C. Your team needs to obtain a unified log view of all the development cloud project in your SIM. The development project are under the non-prod organization folder with the test and pre-production project. The development project share the ABC billing account with the rest of the org. Which logging export strategy should you use to meet this requirement? Export log to the cloud pub sub topic folder and push it. Subscribe to SIM or create storage sync for the billing account for the parent and set it to false in a dedicated SIM project. Process the cloud storage or export the logs or create cloud storage sync with the publicly shared cloud. So the answer is B. Create a cloud storage sync with the billing account ABC. Part and include the children property which set to false. Then process the object in SIM. That was the trick. Your team wants to limit users with admin privileges at the org level. Which two roles should your team restrict? Org admin, yes. Super admin, yes. JKE cluster admin, compute admin, org role view. So the answer is A and B. Super admin. And org admin, this is like enterprise administrator on premise. Okay. your team wants to make sure a compute engine instance running in your production project do not have public IP address. The front end application compute will require public IP. The project engineers have the editor role to modify resource. Your team wants to enforce the requirement. Which one is the right answer to do this? Enable private access, remove the editor role, or set up an org policy to permit public IP as a front end, or set up VPC with two subnets? The answer is C. Okay, you set up a org policy which permit only public IP address at the front, not back end and others, okay? In the effort of your company measuring the application comply with FIPS 142, the decision was made to use GCP. The messaging app architecture, including managing instance group that control the cluster compute engine instance. The instance used local SSD for data caching and UDP instance to instance communication. The app development team is willing to make any changes necessary to comply with the standard. Which options should you recommend to meet the requirement? Encrypt all the cache storage and VM to VM communication. Set disk encryption on the instance temple using MIG, customer managed data, sorry, keys. Change the app instance. Communication from UDP TCP, no. Set disk encryption on the instance template used by MIG, Google managed key, and use the boring SSL library on all the instance. So the answer is, in my opinion, D. Let's have a look. Set disk encryption on the instance template and use that used by the MIG to the managed identity with the library SDKs. Next is, while migrating your org to GCP, a large number of users will need to access GCP console. The identity management team already has a well established to manage your users and using LDAP or AD. What should you do? Manually sync the data to Google domain with your existing AD or LDAP. Use Google Cloud Direct Sync to sync the data to Google domains and LDAP. Use single sign-on and use OpenID. So the answer is B. Using Google Cloud Direct Sync to sync the identity so we can utilize them to do single sign-on, okay? Next is, you are the security admin of your company. Your development team create multiple GCP projects under the implementation folder for several dev, staging, and protection workload. You want to prevent data getting exploited by some of the malicious attacks and by setting up security perimeter. However, you don't restrict communication between the project. What should you do? You shell VPC to enable communication between all the project, or create access control level to prevent data exfiltration and use shared VPC, or use infrastructure as a code tool to set up single surface parameter and deploy cloud function, or use infrastructure as a code tool to set up the three different surface parameters. The simple answer, they all like seems correct. However, B is the most familiar, or I will say solid and costly option. Create, access level, access context manager to prevent data exfiltration and use shared VPC to achieve the rest. You need to perform vulnerability scan for your app via cloud security scanner. Upon completion of the scan, the report is not producing the expected number of your web result. The page in the app with the mouse over menu are missing from the report. Which action should you take to make sure the scan completes successfully and capture the menu part? Verify the URL, excluded URL, modify the scan schedule, change the scan to include additional starting URL, adjust Google account. That's let's see basically. Make sure you take care of additional basically scanning or URLs. You are on your company dev team, you notice that your application hosted in staging in JKE, you know, the Kubernetes in Google, dynamically including user data in web pages without first properly validating the data. This could allow an attacker basically to impersonate and, you know, use it to basically inject some data into your users' browsers. What should you do to fix this issue? Use cloud IP-based address end users, set up HTTPS load balancer, use web security scanner to validate the usage of the outdated library, and which is correct that one, and use web security scan again in staging, okay, to simulate, you know, injection attack, and then use the templating system that's supporting the auto scaping. So basically C and D they're correct, but D is the sort of more right approach because you will be simulating an attack and then you can address the issue. Next is, which encryption algorithm is used with the default encryption in the cloud storage? Default is 256. Okay, not sure. It's using AES 256, which I mean the answer is A, not 512. Yeah, the default. Next, your team wants to centrally manage, you know, GCP IAM permission for their on-premise AD. Your team wants to manage the permission by AD group membership. What should you do to achieve that? Set up AD sync and IAM on the group, set up SAML and IAM, set up cloud access management to create groups IAM from AD, use admin SDK. That's the C, basically. Okay, next, your team create an integrated firewall rule to allow SSH access from their corporate IP range to a specific bastion host. Yeah, your team wants to make sure that this firewall rule cannot be used unauthorized engineers who may otherwise have access to managed VMs. What should you do to address this? Create firewall rule with large target tags and centrally manage access to these tags, or create firewall rules with a target of service account and centrally manage the access to that service account, or create firewall rule in VPC with a tag and again share VPC with specific subnet. I will go for the service account, which is B. Create firewall rule with service account and I target the service account per subnet. You want to protect default VPC network from all the inbound and outbound internet traffic. What should you do to achieve that? Create deny inbound firewall, create deny all outbound internet firewall, create a new subnet in VPC with a private, and create instance without external access. The question is, you want to protect all default VPC network from all inbound and outbound internet traffic. By default, all inbound is allowed. Outbound is basically denied. So what I need to do, I need to disable all the inbound as well. Okay. A DevOps team will create a new container to run Google Kubernetes engine. The application will be internal facing, they want to minimize the attack surface on the container. What should they do? Build small containers using small base image. Use a cloud build to build the container. Delete non-used version of the container registry. Use continuous delivery tool to deploy the application. Basically, use a CI/CD, which is D. That will help you to deploy the app and then remove anything you don't need. Okay. You are in charge of migrating legacy application from your company data center to GCP before current maintenance window. You do not want the port an application is using and non-documented is available. Basically, I want to migrate an application. I have no idea what port my app is using, and there's no documentation. What shall I do? You want to accomplish this without, you know, putting any risk. So, migrate the application into isolated project using lift and shift. Doesn't work like this, Adam. Migrate the application into an isolated project using lift and shift approach, custom network. Refactor the application into microservices, like, you know, JKE, okay, and disable traffic from outside the network. Then the cluster using firewall rule, using VPC flow logs to determine what the traffic is hitting. Again, refactor microservices D with agile project, disable the traffic from outside using firewall role, using VPC to determine what traffic should be hitting. I mean, C and D are both seems like very close. However, if we look closely to this one, I don't need to make it too complicated. I can just use basically, you know, refactor it, put it in Kubernetes, and then analyze the logs through the VPC, and that should be it. Basically, yeah. So the answer is C. Next is a customer deployed an application onto compute engine that takes advantage of the elastic nature of the cloud. How can you work with the infrastructure operation engineer to best ensure that the Windows compute engine of the VMs are up to date? Build a new base image and patch it and available using CI/CD pipeline, deploying incremental federated domain, use deployment manager to provision update VM into the new service group, or reboot all the VM during a weekly maintenance window and allow them to get update. That's, let's we go for D. I mean, C is correct as well, but let's we go for D because when they get rebooted on weekly basis, they get the updates, similar to like what we used to do with this, you know, Citrix as well. Okay. And the last question. A large retailer is moving to GCP when it's a commerce website. So I need to move everything with the website. The company wants to ensure the payment information is encrypted between the browser and GCP backend or the checkout online. What should you do? You need to configure layer 7 with certificate or certificate with TCP load balancer or firewall inbound port 3 for free with block incoming or outgoing. Of course, I need to put layer 7 with an encryption requirement and SSL. So the answer is A. The last question. A customer has an analytics workload running on compute engine that should have limited internet access. Your team created an egress firewall rule to deny priority 1000 traffic to the net. The compute engine instance now need to reach out for a public repo to get some security update. What shall we do? Or what shall the team do? Create egress firewall rule to allow traffic to the CIDR or to the host name of the repo. I'm not going to allow CIDR range. I just need to allow to the host itself, and the host will take care of the DNS resolving, you know, anything greater than 1000. So the answer is C. That was the last questions for part 8. Hopefully we have learned something useful, and I shall see you in the next session. Goodbye, and thank you for watching.